But when nobody was watching, I was coming close to him and I was asking him, what have you got? What is it? And he kept telling me, Jesus. And I was going, I want what you have. I would give my whole world to get what you have. I wanted to become a Christian, but I didn't have it in me, because I thought all my mates would laugh at me. I remember not having a seatbelt on, and it was a mizzly night in September time, going round the corner, and the alloyed wheels didn't stick. And I remember the car going straight, not turning. And I thought, oh dear, this is not right. Hello, my name is Adrian Curry. I'm born and bred in Derry, and I'm just on to give my testimony today. Well, for me, growing up, from childhood, my reading and spelling was completely terrible. They didn't diagnose me as dyslexic, or they didn't diagnose me as anything. So I struggled more or less through primary school. I struggled through secondary school. So 1992, I go on for a job interview. First job interview, I was panicking. I was nervous. I got the job. So here's me now in a meat plant down in Lisnahalley. And I remember coming back with my wee paycheck. Every week, you know, at that time it was under £60. And I says, there you go, Mum, you know, so proud. By this time I was meeting new friends and new people, and we were all going out partying every week. You know, because now I had a wee bit of finances, because I had a wee bit of money, I thought, this is great. So I was out partying every single week. But there's one thing I never missed, and it was a church on a Sunday. Now, I went to church every single Sunday without fail. I couldn't tell you what the minister was preaching because I wasn't listening. Just the fact me being there, I felt good. And I lived off that for years, week in and week out. And I came to a point where there was a man in Foreign Meats by the name of Chris Brown. He was a Christian guy who loved the Lord. And every time I was around him, I felt peace. Now, a lot of people would slag him and put him down and call him Holy Joe and call him all different types of stuff. But when nobody was watching, I was coming close to him and I was asking him, what have you got? What is it? And he kept telling me, Jesus. And he kept telling me, God. And I was going, I want what you have. I would give my whole world to get what you have. This was going on for a long period of time. I wanted to become a Christian, but I didn't have it in me, because I thought all my mates would laugh at me. God placed the Christian into my pathway. They teach me how to drive. And you know what kind of car it was? It was a Lada Samara. And all my mates were slagging me for driving a Lada. But you know what? I didn't care, because this guy was a Christian. I was driving away. And you know, the day of the test, that Lada broke down. And I came with a Citroen ZX to my house. And I looked out and it was a white car. And it was normally a brown one. Where's the car? Oh, he goes, it's broke down. Yeah, I need that Lada, because I was used to it. And you know what he says to me? He says, if you can drive one car, you can drive them all. And I thought, you're a Christian, you don't lie. That must be true. So I remember getting under that car, driving down, and I remember passing that test that day. To this day, I don't know how I done it. So I remember then praying for a car. I says, right, God, if you're there, if you get me a car, I'll become a Christian. So I was okay. So it was my birthday around Christmas, the 23rd of December, my birthday. And I remember walking out of my own house and going down to my sister's house down the street. And I walked in the house and they were all in the house and they were all saying, did you see your present? I says, no, where is it? And they took me outside and it was a red Nova. And you know what? My heart melted. I was crying and doing all that. So here's me now, you know, praying for things and God delivering them to me. Me being me, I got it all done up. Allies on it. I got a wee Fido Dido man in the back of the window. I had a sound system that could rock the place. I remember going over to Shippey Street, driving all round Shippey Street, the window down, the music blaring, thinking I've got it all. And I remember one night, me and my friend Gary Curry, we went out a run in the car. And I remember we went to the jet filling station and there was two girls standing there. One was my cousin and the other one wasn't. So we decided to pick these two girls up and we decided to go, you know, let's go a wee run. So we went up to the Ness Woods. So me and her started talking and she had a necklace on, a wee Christian necklace. She says, you know, as long as I'm wearing this, no harm can come to me. And I thought to myself, well, that's not literally true because you could still die. Like, you know what? I want to drop the subject of talking about God because, you know, I had one of these books here in my car. But, you know, the problem was I couldn't read it. My reading ability was useless. But I had it in my car and I had it in the front glove compartment of my car and it was locked. But I didn't want anybody to know it was there. But anyway, we dropped the subject. My friend says, right, I'm away on here. I'll see you later. We started the engine on the car And if anybody knows the Ness Woods back in them days, you had to sort of go round a corner and then go on a big straight. But in the corner, there was a bridge. And I remember not having a seatbelt on. And it was a mizzly night in September time, going round the corner, and the alloyed wheels didn't stick. And I remember the car going straight, not turning. And I remember hitting like a fence. And I thought, oh dear, this is not right. And then I remember then the car actually hit a fence like this. And then it was going like this, and I was going, that's not right either. And then I actually fell a 16-foot drop on the roof of the car and the stream. If I had been wearing a seatbelt, I would never have got an opportunity to give my life to Jesus. The headrest on my side was completely smashed. You know, the roof right on the headrest. And I was flipped upside down in the car. And her side of the car was completely and utterly perfect. I remember sitting, lying upside down in that car, going, first thought, my ma's going to kill me. That's it. I'm dead. Ah. And the second thought then was, where was I going? I didn't know where I was going because I hadn't made my life right with God yet. I wanted to do it, but I didn't do it. I remember she was a good woman. She busted out of the car and she dragged me out of the car. She, come on, let's get out of here quick. We could have died here. And I remember walking a full mile. That whole mile I was saying to this girl who I never met, I'm giving my life to Jesus. I'm not wasting my life anymore. I can't do this anymore. I've got to get right with God. And she was looking at me as going, are you okay? Are you all right? That accident really hard on you there. But you know, I didn't care anymore. I really didn't care. And the Lord spoke to me that night. I looked up on the bridge and the Lord audibly says to me, he says, where was your friends there? That's what he says to me, because I didn't become a Christian because of my mates, thinking, you know, I'll lose them. They'll not want to know me anymore. But that's what he says to me. Where was your friends there? I got a phone call from the church. A boy called Johnny Glenn says to me, he says, would you like to go on a youth fellowship weekend? My outer man was going, don't go, your mates will laugh at you, going to a church, holy Jew and all this. But my inner man was crying out. And you know, I says, I'm going to go to that church weekend. And I went on that church weekend, the 23rd of September, 1997. I bowed my knees to Christ. I gave my life to Jesus that weekend. And the very first time in my life I have ever had peace. You know, if I was to die 5 seconds after I give my life to Christ, I couldn't care less, because I had found peace with my God. I had found peace with Jesus. He was real to me. And now here, a person now who can't read and can't spell, what can I do for you, God? So I remember that summer of 97, we had to go down to Portrush. Now, God has a sense of humor. I partied in Portrush, and now he's taking me down to do ministry in Portrush. So my first job at CSSM was guarding a pulpit. Because my spelling and reading was rubbish, I couldn't do it. I couldn't take a Sunday school class, I couldn't do any of it. So I guarded a pulpit for the first week. That was my job. Any kid went on that pulpit, they were getting knocked off. But you know, the first week I was thinking, I want to teach children about Jesus. And so I remember Jonathan Glenn, who was the one who invited me on that weekend. I says to him, I says, can you help me? If I can sit down with you the night before and go through a Bible story, then I could try and memorize it and I can try and teach the kids. And for the second week, I was teaching children about God, teaching children about Jesus, and teaching children Bible stories. And I remember on that last day of that week, three young people gave their life to Christ. Three young people said the sinner's prayer and asked Jesus Christ to come into their heart. And you know, I never looked back after that. So I was asking God for a wife, you know, a future wife, as you do. There was this girl in the Mavati, and I thought, I could be in here. So I brung my wee nephew with me, because she was staying with a friend down in the Mavati, and I brung my nephew with me. And I says to my nephew, I says, if anything goes wrong here, just you say you need to go home, because there's an emergency in the house, and we'll get out. So I remember driving down that night, and I was praying and asking God to save, you know, my nephew, because I hadn't popped the question yet. They let him know about salvation. I was waiting for the right moment. And I remember going down into that house, and I went in and I sat down in the couch nervously. She comes out of the room, doesn't even look at me, doesn't take me on, and looks at Daryl and starts talking to Daryl, and then says to Daryl at the end of the conversation, would you like to give your life to Christ? And dead silence came over the room. And I was sitting there and I was about to just chirp up, it's too early, where he just turned around and he says, I want to give my life to Jesus. I want to get saved tonight. She didn't even speak to me that night. Okay. And I was raging because I was going down to try and make, you know, me and her to get together. And, you know, but you know something, when I look back on that, that was more important, getting him in with the Lord than me and her going off and having a relationship. About a week later, I phoned her. This was very awkward for me because I was very shy. This is the way the conversation went. There's somebody that I really like and I really want to say that I really love. Can I say it? And she says, go ahead, I say it. And I says, well, it's you. I really like you and I really love you and I really want to go out with you. Then I says to her, is there anybody that you really like and is there anybody that you really love? Would, you know? And she says, yes. And I was sitting on the edge of the phone like this going, I hope it's me. And I says, who is it? And she goes, Jesus. And I was going, oh, come on. Do you want to go out with me or not? So it was the year 2000. We got together and dated within a year and married within a year. And then 2001 came along a son and I called him Caleb. Then the Lord called me to Bible college. I went to Bible college over in Scotland with the Faith Mission Bible College. And that was hard because you had to sort of read a lot of books and write a lot. So I struggled with my reading and I struggled with my spelling. But I got by and I got there. I wanted to come back home. And I went to a place called the Apostolic Church. And we started a club called Club Lighthouse. So we had a group of 20 young people all coming together on a Friday night. And we were running kids clubs. We were running all that. We could do dramas. We could just make a drama up like this. And the team would come out and do the drama. Souls would get saved for the kingdom. People would come and say, I want to become a Christian. How do I do it? And we led a lot of people to Christ back in them days. And then the Lord sort of called me. I was doing Bible studies. And then I became a minister within the church. I was still working on foreign meets. And I was doing street soccer as well. And I was pastoring. And I was doing a lot of stuff at that time within my life. As I say, street soccer now, I actually work full time for street soccer. And we play football. And it's a great opportunity to show love, just to show Jesus. It's wee seeds. You sow wee seeds into people's lives, week in and week out. You think you're not getting anywhere. And then all of a sudden, somebody pops up and goes, I want to become a Christian. How do I do it? And then somebody came up and says, would you like to become a chaplain? Now, again, I was saying, how could I do that? For a year, I struggled. You know, I would go to the matches or I would go to training and just sit back and not speak to too many people. And, you know, the Lord really convicted me of that. The Lord says, what are you doing? Are you a chaplain or are you not? And I thought, no, if I say I want to do a thing, I want to do it with a pure heart and I want to be there. And you know something, for the last couple of months, I've really been enjoying myself as a chaplain. I can get in there amongst the boys, tell them about Jesus, let them know about God, and do it in a way that's not down your throat. That's probably me up to date from start to where I am now. But can I just say, if you're sitting there and you're struggling, folks, I'm just saying this because there's probably people listening to this voice and you want to become a Christian, but you're thinking the reaction of people. I pulled myself away from everybody, folks, because of my mindset. And I remember walking up to the Drumahoe chip shop. All my mates were at that chip shop. And I was going, here we go. What do you see what's going to happen? They're going to slag me. They're going to pull me down or whatever. And I remember the main guy, a boy called Warren King, was there. He was a tough boy at that time. He called me over. Flick. That was my nickname. Flick, come here. We haven't seen you in a long time. Where have you been? And I put my head down and I says, no, I'm a Christian now. And I'm just going to church a lot. And my head was down. And he looked up and he said, get your head up. He says, you're a Christian. Fair play to you, son. I'm really proud of you. And when he says that, something inside me, it just busted open. And I was going, are you serious? He goes, yes. And this is what he says. He says, every bird, when it grows up, has to open its wings and fly its own direction. Now, you see, when he said that, all the lies of the enemy told me, fell off me. And I was so happy. But up until that point, I was always down on myself, thinking nobody's for me and everybody's against me. The enemy lied to me for months. And you know, I had so much freedom with them men. I could call around to them today. I can speak to them today. They'll show love towards me today. And it was all a lie from the enemy. So don't let the enemy lie to you. Now, I'm going to say a wee prayer now. And if you want to say this prayer, you can give your life to Jesus right now, listening to this YouTube video. Dear Lord Jesus, I ask you to come into my heart. Forgive me for my sin. Open up my eyes and let me see wonderful things in your law today, God. So Jesus, right now, thank you for the cross. Thank you for taking my sin, and thank you that I'm free. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, there's a party up in heaven now because you have given your life to Christ. When you do that, it's like a big blackboard. All your sins was wrote on that blackboard. And now all of a sudden, when you give your life to Christ, he has taken this here and just cleaned the whole blackboard. So you're free from sin. You're free from it. You don't go back. You don't look back. You know, you go forward. You get yourself a church. Get yourself a Bible. Get in contact with the guy that's running this place, Josh. You get yourself training. We're there to help you. We love you. We want the best for you. And get on course with Jesus. It's the best decision you could ever make. So thank you very much for listening.